So the relationship with sleep disorder breathing. We have to consider snoring. What is it? But the exchange of a large volume of air through a narrowed space. Two things are going on here. The exchange of a large volume of air. If we breathe heavy during the day, we breathe heavy during our sleep. And the second aspect is the size of the space, the diameter of the airway. We cannot consider one without the other. Can you imagine a plumber coming to your house and the plumber has to determine the diameter of the pipe bringing water from, say, one aspect of the house, one part of the house to the other? Can you imagine the plumber just choosing the size of a pipe at random without considering the amount of water that's expected to go through it? The two go hand in hand, and with breathing, they also go hand in hand. Large breathing volume, narrowed space. Two types of snoring, snoring with the mouth open. Very easy to address. All you have to do is get the mouth closed. The second type of snoring is high upper airway resistance, turbulent airflow in the nasopharynx. It's the more difficult one. We show people how to decongest their nose. We show people how to bring their breathing volume down towards normal. No devices, no gadgets, just simple feedback. We look at an individual's breathing and we give them simple breathing exercises, which we'll practice as a group. And I'd really like you to practice them because I can talk about them, but until you experience the effect, you know, it gives you a better perspective of it. And of course, the next progression is obstructive sleep apnea. Normal minute volume, if you were to look, this is a 2009 book. If you were to look at normal minute volume, it's 4 to 6 liters of air per minute. So generally we have 10 and 12 breaths. Each breath is half a liter and that's giving us our 4 to 6 liters of air. That is considered normal. But when we look at asthma, and the reason that I'm bringing up asthma is because I'm going to tie in asthma with obstructive sleep apnea. There is something going on with asthma that's also going on in OSA. And we have to find out why. What is the relationship? But people with asthma are breathing between 10 and 15 liters of air per minute. Now, as Omar pointed out earlier on, he says, we live without food for weeks, we live without water for days, we live without air for just a few minutes. You all know how much food you should be eating every day. You all have an idea how much water you should be drinking. But how much air should you be breathing? Is it healthy to breathe 2 to 3 times the volume of air every minute, every hour, every day? In a medical textbook, normal breathing is considered 4 to 6 liters of air per minute. That's here. If somebody walks into a doctor's surgery and they're having a panic or asthma attack, they can be having 20 to 30 liters of air per minute. That's here. That's recognized. Normal breathing is recognized. Excessive breathing is during a panic attack is recognized. Nobody is looking at the piece in the middle. If you get very sick in the short term by breathing 20 to 30 liters of air per minute, well, my question is, well, if you're breathing 2 to 3 times more than what you should be every minute, every hour, every day, are you also going to get sick? And it's not just that asthma is causing overbreathing. It's the feedback that overbreathing is literally sucking moisture out of the airways and causing inflammation to feed back into it. There's a feedback loop. And I also believe the same feedback loop is with OSA. Never studied, very seldom, minute volume with obstructive sleep apnea. How much air does the individual breathe? In this paper here, they looked at 20 obese men with OSA and normal lung function. And they were found to be breathing 15 liters of air per minute. Minute volume, 15 liters. Normal is 4 to 6. They're breathing 2 to 3 times more. The next, in the same paper, 12.8, these people have overlap syndrome. They've got both OSA and COPD, but they're still breathing excessively. And when we look at OSA, we have to consider flow. I'm just going to play a short video.
Obstructive sleep apnea occurs when the upper airways collapse, resulting in holding of the breath during sleep. After a period of time, the sleeper partially wakes up, gasping for air. This cycle of breath holding followed by gasping can occur many times an hour during sleep. In addressing obstructive sleep apnea, two factors need to be considered. The first is airway size, and the second is the amount of air that we habitually breathe. In relation to airway size, the narrower the upper airway, the greater the negative pressure as air is drawn into the lungs. Habitual mouth breathing during childhood can alter the shape of the face, resulting in small or receding jaws. This reduces airway size and increases the risk of lifelong sleep apnea. As we get older, loss of muscle tone in the upper airway also contributes to holding of the breath during sleep. To help open the upper airway, it is important not to sleep on the back and also to breathe through the nose. The second consideration in obstructive sleep apnea is the amount of air that we breathe. It is very common for people to habitually breathe too much air, as indicated by audible breathing often through the mouth. Heavy breathing during sleep increases negative pressure in the upper airways, causing collapse. Imagine inhaling a large volume of air through a collapsible paper straw. The heavier one breathes, the greater the likelihood of the walls of the straw collapsing inwards. On the other hand, breathing light through the straw causes less negative pressure, thereby reducing the risk of collapsing the walls. Breathing re-education to reset the breathing center in the brain to a lighter breathing volume significantly reduces the occurrence of obstructive sleep apnea. Combining this with myofunctional therapy to strengthen the upper airways enhances the benefits, resulting in a significant reduction in apneas and hypopneas.
Okay, so it would be based on the Bernoulli principle. And basically this states that as fluid flows, a negative pressure develops at the periphery of the flow. But most importantly, as flow velocity increases, so does the negative pressure. So the best way to imagine it is breathing through a paper straw, a collapsible paper straw. The upper airways is collapsible. If you breathe hard, you're going to cause negative pressure on the inner walls of the airways to cause and collapse. And the other aspect about this is that if positive pressure helps open up the airway, reducing negative pressure should also help ensure that the airway will stay more open. And the second factor of this is the Venturi effect, and this is looking at airway size. And basically, as a given volume of fluid moves through a conduit of decreasing diameter, the velocity of the fluid will increase. The narrower the upper airway, the greater the velocity. There's two aspects going on. We have the Bernoulli principle, which is solely looking at air volume, breathing volume. And we have the Venturi effect, which is looking at airway size. And when we look, what is obstructive sleep apnea? But collapse of the upper airway occurs if the negative upper airway pressure generated by inspiratory pump muscles exceeds the dilating force of these upper airway muscles. And that definition is taken from a number of papers looking at obstructive sleep apnea. Again, let's look at breathing. This here is what's called a Starling resistor model. And it's very interesting in terms of if there's an obstruction in the front of the airway vis-a-vis the nose, if the nose is blocked, and if it's difficult to breathe through the nose, it will increase the negative pressure further on the airway. So we're talking about breathing volume. We're also talking about nasal obstruction. So it behaves like a Starling resistor in that obstruction at the inlet, the nasal airway, produces collapsing forces that are manifest downstream in the collapsible segment, the pharynx. So the basic message so far is breathe through the nose and breathe lightly.